إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا وبعد. Respected elders, scholars, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. All praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has bestowed upon us this opportunity, and our thanks is due to Him. But alhamdulillah for the beautiful weather. It's a bit dangerous out on the roads. The traffic is a bit hectic, and I'm sure many people. But alhamdulillah. We say alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. Alhamdulillah in every condition. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to receive those lemons and make the lemonade. Because that's the attitude with which Muslims look at life. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us something, we have to appreciate it and admire it and accept that gift. Alhamdulillah. Not to go too much into a lengthy introduction, but suffice to say that a week ago we spoke about a particular important conversation that took place in the history of mankind. And that was the conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and... Did we forget what we spoke about last week? This is how we're going to go now to the Jumuah of the year. We're going to forget what our discussions are about. We spoke about the conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. We said we were going to look at it in the Quran, which is known as the Kalam of Allah. So we're looking in the Kalam of Allah, about the Kalam of Allah, to the Kalim of Allah, we said. We highlighted that particular part. Because Musa alayhi salam, just to reiterate, Musa alayhi salatu wa salam was known as Kalimullah, the one who could communicate and speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke directly to him in the dunya. So, we started off, and I'm going to do a 5-minute recap on the topic. Because clearly we need the recap. We're going to do a 5-minute recap on the topic and look at the lessons that we derived and we touched on last week. And then we will continue, inshallah, and hopefully by the end of today's Jumu'ah, we will be able to conclude the few lessons that we can derive in this particular time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. Has the story of Moses reached you? The story of Moses, has it reached you? إِذْ رَأَى نَارًا فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِهِ أَمْكِثُوا إِنِّي آنَسْتُ نَارًا لَعَلِّي آتِيكُم مِّنْهَا بِقَبَسٍ أَوْ أَجِدُ عَلَى النَّارِ هُدًى. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, do you remember? When Musa alayhi salatu wasalam saw the fire with his family, he said to his family, just wait here, I'm going to go to the fire and perhaps I will be able to provide you some burning, some heat, something to keep you warm. أَوْ أَجِدَ عَلَى النَّارِ هُدًى. Or I will be able to get some guidance for you from the fire. We highlighted that the guidance and the warmth was we could look see it in two ways. The first way was to understand that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was looking for physical warmth. And he was looking for physical guidance, in other words, a torch to light up the way. But at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had something greater in store for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to meet him, or communicate with him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to provide him with the true light or true guidance as it were. فَلَمَّا آتَاهَا نُودِيَ يَا مُوسَى. When Musa alayhi salatu wasalam came to the light, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called out to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, إِنِّي أَنَا رَبُّكَ فَخْلَعْ نَعْلَيْكَ إِنَّكَ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ تُوَى. He said to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, verily I am your Lord, therefore, and you are in my presence. Take your shoes off in my presence, because you are in the sacred valley of Tuwa. So we learn from that when we approach our Maker, our Creator, we need to approach Him with all respect. One of the ways of exhibiting this respect is to take off our shoes, to come in a clean environment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That clean environment not only being our physical purity, but our mental and emotional purity needs to be there as well, inshaAllah. وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, I have chosen thee. So then, listen. فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. Listen to what I will inspire you with. Innani ana Allah. I am your Allah. I am Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces himself. I am Allah. La ilaha illa ana. There is no God except me. Fa'budni. Worship me. Wa aqim as-salata lidh-dhikri. And perform salah for my remembrance. Inna as-sa'ata atiyatun akadu fiha litujza kullu nafsin bima tas'a. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily the hour is coming, and this is where we stop. We're going to continue from here. But in the first few examples, we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches, we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us signs. We learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words are light and guidance. We learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses what He wills as He wills. So there's no point in us being jealous. We spoke about the masjid and those kinds of things, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses certain pieces of land over others. And then we ended on the topic of Salah, salah, salah. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Innani ana Allah, la ilaha illa ana, fa'budni wa aqim as-salata lidh-dhikri. That establish salah for my remembrance. And we looked at the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most certainly Musa alayhi salam would not have forgotten this conversation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, despite this fact, reminds, says to him, don't only worship me, but perform your salah, but aqim as-salata lidh-dhikri. Establish your salah for my remembrance. And we know as Muslims, we are commanded to establish our salah 5 times a day. 5 times a day. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because naturally we are forgetful. Then we looked at the story of Sayyidina Hanzala, who came to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and said, I have become a munafiq. I have become guilty of hypocrisy. And then Abu Bakr said, well, if that's the case, he said, he explained to him, I'm just going through it very quickly. He said, well, why do you say you become a munafiq? He says, well, when we're in the company of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then I can see Jannah and Jahannam. It's like they are in front of me. But the minute we leave, I play with my children, I look at my wife, I get involved in business, I forget. He says, well, then I'm also munafiq. Let's go to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he explains his situation to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, if you were to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like how you did in my presence, then the malaika will come and greet you on your beds, and they will come and wait for you on your pathways to greet you. That's the caliber of person you'd be if this was possible. Therefore, when we say aqim as-salat al-dhikri, we know it's natural for us to forget. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put it as such that 5 times a day, we will come back and we will remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the form of our salah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding of that, inshaAllah. إن الساعة آتية أكاد فيها لتجزى كل نفس بما تسعى. Verily the hour is coming, says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My desire is to keep it hidden for every soul. The day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment is not known. To receive its reward by the measure of its endeavor. To receive its reward by the measure of its endeavor. As you sow. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, الدنيا غزرة للآخرة. That the world is a tillage field for the year after. This world is a tillage field for the year after. As you sow, so shall you reap. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to sow good so that we can reap the good, inshaAllah. فَلَا يَسُدَّنَّكَ عَنْهَا مَنْ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهَا وَأَتْبَعَ هَوَاهُ فَتَرْدَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, therefore, let not such as those who believe therein, that let there not be a case that you do not believe therein, but you follow your own lust and desires, and they divert you from the right path, lest you will be amongst those, فَتَرْدَ, you will be amongst those who will perish. But I want to now, that was sort of the end of the last discussion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these two verses reminds us, and he reminds Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that if you turn away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, therefore not, فَلَا يُصَدَّرْنَكَ عَنْهَا مَنْ لَا يُمِنُ. Let not those who disbelieve turn you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let them not turn you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remind Musa alayhi salatu wasalam of this? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, you may be punished as well. And that teaches us that the best of people also need to be reminded. Here was Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Kaleem of Allah, the Prophet of Allah, that would be reminded that if he turned away, there would be severe consequences. Do we then not as people also need that reminder, that reminder of the day of judgment and of the fire of Jahannam and the rewards of Jannah? Do we not to be reminded as well? So the best of people also, if Musa alayhi salam can be reminded of the day of judgment, then how can we regard ourselves so arrogant, so proud, that we don't want other people to tell us and remind us about the day of judgment? We ask people when they rectify us, who are you to tell me? Forget, don't look at who is telling you, look at what is being said to you. Look at what is being said to you and accept the reminder, because even Musa alayhi salam had to receive his own reminders. In these verses, in this first half of the conversation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summarizes Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first mentions that none is worthy of worship except Him. La ilaha illa ana fa'budni. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says none is to be worshipped other than Him. He then made clear to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam to establish his salah. Right? And then he makes mention of the day of judgment. And this is what we are all striving for. We all want to enter Jannah. We all want to get there. May Allah grant us inshaAllah. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, to establish our salah, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be mindful of the hereafter. InshaAllah, if we do this, Jannah will be ours by the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. But the conversation of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam becomes very interesting thereafter. Now, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has introduced himself to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gotten all the house rules, as it were, out of the way, take off your shoes, I am so and so, you are so and so, this is what's happening, this is what our religion is about, this is what our relationship is about, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala proceeds to ask Musa alayhi salatu wasalam a very interesting question. He says to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. O Musa, O Moses, what is in your right hand? It's a very strange question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, O Moses, what is in your right hand? Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then not know what is in the right hand of Moses? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unmindful, oblivious, not present, not knowing what is in the hand of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam that warrants the question, مَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. So we learn an important lesson from this, in this conversation. That sometimes a question is asked not because the questioner does not know the answer to the question. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us time and again different situations in which questions are asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are few reasons why questions can be asked. Firstly, as in this example and in other examples, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to draw the attention of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam very emphatically, and to those reading the Quran very purposefully, to the issue of what is in the right hand of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So now, those who have not who cannot remember from the Quran, reading the Quran, what is in the right hand of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, you are puzzled. You are also inquiring, why God then asked Musa, what is in your hand? But to draw your attention to this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked the question. Similarly, in other verses of the Quran, and this is how we study the Quran and we learn to understand the Quran, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks questions, they are not because they really require an answer, because they are rhetorical questions at times. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks in the Quran, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Are they equal, those who know and those who know not? And the answer is quite obvious. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nonetheless wants to draw your attention and emphasize how vast the difference is between those who know and those who know not. And to bring your attention so importantly to this point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the question. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the question to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَىٰ. Oh Moses, what is in your right hand? Another reason we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks questions, for example, is to teach those around us. We are all witnessing the conversation, as it were, recorded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are all witnessing the conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it is the Quran is the absolute truth. And so we are all witness to this truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala acknowledges that He asked Musa alayhi salam, what is in your right hand? But similarly, this methodology that is applied is something that we should apply to others. For example, you are unable to get through to someone. Someone has a problem in your home, whether it be drug abuse, whether it be alcohol abuse, whether it be just simply not doing wudu properly, whether it be someone, you know, and a mother and father having problem with the children. The mother and father can use this methodology of questioning to teach those who are listening about how to behave. Similarly, when Jibreel, in the hadith we mentioned here before, a couple of months ago, when Jibreel comes to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in hadith Jibreel, he sits, فَأَسْنَدَ رُبَّتَي إِلَى رُبَّتَي. He sits with his knees to the knees of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? فَأَسْنَدَ رُبَّتَي وَوَضْعَ كَفَّي أَلَى فَضَّيْ. And he puts his hands on the calves up of the thighs of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَخْبِرْنِي أَنِ الْإِسْلَامِ. Inform me of Islam. Right? Then the Prophet says, فَقَالَ رَسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْإِسْلَامُ أَنْ تَشْهَدَ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَتُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةَ وَتُؤْتِيَ الزَّكَاةَ وَتَصُومَ رَمَضَانَ وَتَحُجَّ الْبَيْتَ إِنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. He says, Islam is to believe in Allah, to perform your salah, to fast in month of Ramadan, to go for Hajj. So that's the Prophet's response. Then Jibreel says, صَدَّقْتَ. You have spoken the truth. And then the narrator of the hadith, which is Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, says, فَأَجِبْنَا لَهُ يَسْأَلُهُ وَيُصَدِّقُهُ. We were surprised. He asked the question and he confirms that the answer was correct. Which means Jibreel knew the answer to the question that he was asking. And at the end of the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reminds Umar ibn al-Khattab. He says, ثُمَّ قَالَ يَا عُمَرْ أَتَدْرِي مَنِ السَّائِلِ. Oh Umar, do you know who the questioner was? قَالَ فَإِنَّهُ جِبْرِيلِ أَتَاكُمْ يُعَلِّمُكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. It was Jibreel, he came to teach you people about your deen. Because both Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Jibreel knew the answers to the question. It was the people around that was to create that emphasis, that teacher, that scenario of where you could role play what was right and what was wrong, and how to answer something, and how to have adab, and what the correct way of belief was. They did this role play to teach the Sahaba ikram so that message could come down to us. So we see another reason for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asking Musa alayhi salam, وَمَا بِتِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَىٰ. It's also to teach us how and why questions are asked. Right? And then the last reason, for one of the, there are many, perhaps other reasons as well, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also asks questions to test us. For example, we are will be questioned in the qabr. Man rabbuka? Who is your Lord? The questioner knows the answer, but the questioner is asking the question to see whether the answerer will know the answer, because there is a consequence for not knowing that answer or for knowing that answer. May Allah make our qabr easy for us, inshaAllah. So there are various reasons. So it's very intense how the Mufassireen have looked at just the verse, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَىٰ. Oh Moses, what is in your right hand? But that obviously is not the end of the conversation. قَالَ هِيَ عَصَايَ. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam says, oh, in my right hand? Well, this is my asa. This is my stick. That was what was in the right hand of Musa alayhi salam. هِيَ عَصَايَ. أَتَوَكَّأُ عَلَيْهَا وَأَهُشُّ بِهَا عَلَى غَنَمِي وَلِيَ فِيهَا مَآلِبُ أُخْرَى. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, this is my stick. I lean on it. You know, I put the stick down and I lean on it. Right? أَتَوَكَّأُ عَلَيْهَا وَأَهُشُّ بِهَا عَلَى غَنَمِي. And I use the stick to beat the leaves off the tree, so the trees, so that the sheep that I look after can eat some of the leaves, right? وَلِيَ فِيهَا مَآلِمُ أُخْرَىٰ. And also, with this stick, I find many other uses. Musa alayhi salam? Are you teaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what the simple reason of a stick is? Why Musa alayhi salam, are you telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why are you answering the question? You could have said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, but I mean, if you say you are Allah, like you have introduced yourself to me, then surely you should know what I use the stick, what is in my right hand, and you should know what I use the stick for. Why ask me this ridiculous question of Allah? But Musa alayhi salam doesn't do that. He says, Allah, it's my stick. I lean on it. Seriously, leaning. I just leaned on the minbar now, and I it's insignificant. Why would I say what I lean on the stick when he walks? Here, I use it for that. A simple sub-A conversation is happening here. Musa alayhi salam, you are a prophet of Allah. What are you doing? But it's in the Quran. So Muslims that proudly say, Quran is my constitution, Quran is my everything. Okay, let's just take a time out here. CA392854, a brown Honda parked in front of a driveway opposite the mosque. If that is a musalli, then please move. It's a very bad habit to have, and we don't know what emergency reasons it may have been, but if you are in the masjid, don't stand up, because otherwise we're all going to look at you. But please move your vehicle. Sneak behind people or whatever the case is. Or just excuse yourself, you know. Be sorry. And if you find that someone wanted to come up, please do apologize to them. Say, look, I'm sorry. I didn't notice. I didn't take note of it. I won't happen in the future. It's nothing wrong. But say you're sorry and try not to do it in the future. Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you, inshallah. Let me just read that again. CA392854, Brown Honda, parked in front of the driveway, opposite the mosque. Please move your vehicle. Okay. By the way, that's not a question. As we are discussing that, that is an instruction, we need to do that. Okay, so now Musa al-Islam is having a sub-A conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I lean on the stick, I beat the leaves down from the tree with the stick. But why, the leaders of the Quran, why is Musa al-Islam doing this? Now this is important for us to understand and to know. Once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him the question, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam realizes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking a question, and even though the answer is known, he seizes the opportunity to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgetting what he might have to say, just realizing that here is an opportunity for me to communicate with my Rabb. This is an opportunity for me to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he, instead of all of these things, what does he do? He keeps on going on about his staff, and one would think, you know, as we are thinking about it now, but Musa alayhi salam seizes the opportunity to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's given the opportunity. So we need to ask ourselves, from this important lesson, we are not looking just for conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us time and again to have a conversation with Him, to communicate with Him. But when we perform our salah, we rush through our salah. I'm included in this. We get so occupied with the dunya that we forget who we are communicating with in our salah. We forget so occupied after our food that we rush away. We forget to say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi at'amana wa saqana wa ja'alana min al-muslimin. Thank you Allah for the food and drink and for making us Muslims of Allah. We forget that they also, if Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, being a Nabi of Allah, look for every opportunity to extend his conversation with Allah. For a simple question, he looked to make a long thing of the whole story. We that need to speak to Allah, that need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that need to praise Allah, we have so many opportunities to communicate with Allah. But how often do we look and do we seize that opportunity with both our hands? And this is an important lesson that Mufassirin have written regarding this part of the ayah. Because it is easy to say, and it is easy to think about, and it is easy for us to be amazed. Yeah, you know, that makes so much of sense. But how many of us will this message strike home? For how many of us will it sink into our hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us with a channel of communication with Him in our compulsory salah, And He has given us the option in our optional salah. And He has allowed us with everything we do to speak to Him. Whether we are going to the bathroom, whether we are done with our food, whether we are leaving our homes, whether we are entering the masjid, we have an opportunity to communicate with our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because we don't see Him, because He is not part of our hearts and our minds, it is easy for us to neglect this opportunity of communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those of you who are fathers in the jama'ah will know that there comes a time when your son becomes old. When he is small, or she is small, when your child is small, I've got a daughter at that age now. Why? Everything, they want to know why. You remember if you have a child that is grown up now, when that child was young, just 2 or 3 years old, so inquisitive. Everywhere you went, they wanted to go. Like Mary's lamb, from Mary and the little lamb. Everywhere you went, they wanted to go with you. And now, they sought that time with you. You try to speak to them. You try to teach them as much. But as they grew older, they became near mukallaf. They started getting friends of their own. They started having a mind of their own. Developed in more in their personality. They started going away from you. Now, when they become adolescents, when they're teenagers and they're older, you have to beg them, please communicate with me. Please speak to me. Tell me what is going on in your life. Who are your friends? What do you do? You have to beg them to communicate with you. And sometimes I feel, you know, even as an adult, if my father is there, then I think to myself, he would love me to tell him everything. But sometimes I think I just need to, you know, maybe there's other people I speak to about certain things. But the point I want to make is, it's as if though those loved ones become further in the distance. You don't always communicate with them. How, as fathers, or as our fathers, how much wouldn't they love to just sit with us and have a conversation about nothing? Have a conversation about the weather. Have a conversation about sport. Have a conversation about politics. Whatever interests them. Our parents would love this. And even though this talk isn't about parents, it's to give us an understanding that our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need our conversation. We need His presence in our life. And it is not about just thinking that your Allah is there and everything will be okay. It is about acknowledging His presence in everything you do. And that is why the beauty of Islam is that when you see something beautiful, you are taught at madrasa, say, MashaAllah, what a wonder of Allah. When you receive something that you are grateful for, you say, Alhamdulillah, all praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you begin something, you begin with, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. These things, while they seem trivial to you, because if you don't say Bismillah before you brush your teeth, you consider, well, the teeth are still clean, whether I say Bismillah or not. Whether you don't say Alhamdulillah after eating, you still consider, well, my belly is full, whether I say Bismillah or not. And it is so sad that our perception of reality has become so shallow that we cannot see the barakah that goes beyond by acknowledging the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in everything we do. May Allah grant us the understanding, inshaAllah. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam takes the opportunity to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, the Sahaba used to look for every opportunity to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam comes into Masjid al-Nabawi. And as he comes into the masjid, he finds that there are ropes tied in the masjid. Ropes tied in the masjid. فقال رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم ما هذا الحبل؟ Why are there ropes tied up in the masjid? قالوا هذا حبل لزينب. They said this is the rope of Zainab. فإذا فترت فتعلقت. When she becomes tired while she is praying, تعلقت. She holds onto these ropes and she uses it for support so that she doesn't fall over. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا حلوه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, don't use these ropes. ليصلي أحدكم نشاطه فَإِذَا فَطَرَ فَلْيَقْعُدُ. The Prophet said, you people, when you should not use these robes. When you come to the masjid, you must pray. When you become tired, then you sit down. Take a rest. The point I want to make from this hadith is that perhaps we ask ourselves, why could 330 men defeat thousands of men at the Battle of Badr? Because the quality that they had, when they had the opportunity to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they never let go. They seized the opportunity, even the women folk, as we see in this hadith, used the opportunity because they saw, when I'm in salah, I'm communicating with Allah, I don't want to be absent of this communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we, up, down, touch the ground, it's like you're doing squats in the gym. Even squats, you sit longer so that the muscles can work. But in salah, we run through it so quickly. We don't realize we are engaging with our Maker. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the opportunity to truly engage with Him and take a lesson from Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, inshaAllah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, فَقَالَ أَلْقِيهَا يَا مُوسَى. Oh Musa, throw your asa, throw the stick down. فَأَلْقَاهَا فَإِذَا هِيَ حَيَّةٌ تَسْعَى. Then he threw the stick down, and alas, it was a snake active in motion. The snake of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the stick of Musa had become a snake. I want to wrap up now because we're coming to the end, so I'm going to go through these points very quickly. Everything in life can be a double-edged sword. We learned this from this particular incident of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. He had a stick and it had two sides to the stick. And what is important, a stick can be something very, very passive, and a snake can be something very harmful. But we learn from it that everything in life can be a double-edged sword. We may be given, we can use things for good, but we can also use those very things for bad. Right? And we need to ponder about the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Do we use these blessings for good, or do we use it for bad? The ayah goes further, the Quran goes further by saying, قَالَ خُذْهَا وَلَا تَخَفْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now imagine, Musa threw the stick. In one part of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, وَأَلْقِي عَصَاكَ فَلَمَّا رَأَهَا تَهْتَزُ كَأَنَّهَا جَانٌ وَلَّا مُدْبِرًا. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Musa threw the stick. When he saw, hey, this is a snake, it's alive, he turned his back and he started running. Naturally, you would also do that. I mean, if you saw a stick becoming a snake and becoming alive, you would also run for your life. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stops Musa alayhi salam. But that is in a different ayah, but the same incident explained in this particular ayah. قَالَ خُذْهَا وَلَا تَخَفْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains to Musa alayhi salam, oh Musa, take it, don't fear. خُذْهَا وَلَا تَخَفْ. Now if I told any of you, there's a snake here, pick it up with your hands. You must be big girls to want to do that. But if you're not big girls, I don't believe you are going to pick up that snake. I believe the masjid will be empty. So the thing is, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تَخَفْ. Don't fear. Right? خُذَا وَلَا تَخَفْ سَنُعِيدُهَا سِيرَتَهَا الْأُولَى. Take it and it will become its original shape again. It will become, once you grab the snake, it will become an asa again. It will become a stick again. What do we learn from this? We learn from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we put too little trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We feel that we are the doer of everything. Sometimes we don't, because we don't understand something, we immediately shut it down. Inheritance, we don't understand why a boy must get twice the amount of a girl. No, close my door, my brain cannot conceive that, so I cut it out of my head. Trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Most certainly a snake would bite you and would be very dangerous. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if I am your Allah, and I tell you to take that snake, you take it, believe will become an asa. Believe. So you go through life, oh brothers and sisters in this Jumu'ah today. When you go through life, if Allah has commanded you to do something, put your logic, put your brains one side. Accept what Allah, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Hear and obey. This is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we learn how Musa alayhi salatu wasalam did this. Right? وَضُمْ يَدَكَ إِلَى جَنَاحِكَ تَخْرُجْ بَيْضَى مِنْ غَيْرِ سُوءٍ آيَةً أُخْرَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, take your hand, put it under your arm like this. And when you take it out, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's hand used to be a shining light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, don't worry, this is nothing evil. This is not an evil omen that has come upon you. It is just another one of our signs. And then لِنُرِيَكَ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا الْكُبْرَى. We want to show you, O Moses, about the beautiful signs and the great signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that I've shown you all these things, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gotten the confidence of Musa alayhi salam. He says, اِذْهَبْ إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ إِنَّهُ تَغَى. I'm sending you now. Now go to Fir'aun because he is the one that is astray. Then Musa alayhi salatu wa salam says, قَالَ رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلُ نُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. I leave you with these words because Musa alayhi salatu wa salam once commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do something, he doesn't hesitate. Immediately he must go to Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. And what does he say? Oh Allah, رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي. Oh Allah, he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Open my chest. وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي. Make my matters easy for me, O Allah. وَحْلُ نُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي. And remove the impediment in my speech. يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. So that I may be understood by those who I am going to speak to. Brothers and respected elders, if we go, I've rushed through these two Jumu'ahs, these discussions. If only we can look at the incidents in the Qur'an and derive little benefits from them, we will have the guide that we are so desperately looking. We will be able to provide the guide for humanity that they are so desperately looking for. It is because we have not engaged with the Qur'an. It is because we don't internalize and realize the reality of this message that we fail to find the answers in the Qur'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding and the hidayah, inshaAllah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.